just going to rearrange people. Come, please.
Thank you, Vivek.
Guys, can you move in? Come.
Thank you all. Thank you all for being here today.
Please.
Thanks also to the Serendipity Arts Festival and to Institute Camões for having me here today. I'm going to speak to you about Kaavi art, which I believe is uniquely and originally Goan and has gone from Goa to Maharashtra and Karnataka for sure. So without much preamble, I'd like to speak a little bit about the art scene in Goa at the moment. As some of you know, Goa Heritage Action Group used to have this Spontaneous Festival of the Arts. We had it 5 years in a row in the neighborhood of Spontaneous. And from what I see now, and you'll have to forgive me for saying this, is that a lot of our work is very narcissistic. Even today, we are reflecting our own selves, which is not a bad thing. But I also urge you as artists, sculptors, creative people, poets, writers from Goa to draw from within and close to your culture or your own culture. When I first came to Goa in 1995, I heard the word identity, Goan identity, a lot. And I also heard Asmitai, Daesh, for example. Now I don't hear it. It's not like we've lost touch with our identity. It's just that we are not drawing enough from our culture. So I urge you as artists and creative people working in Goa, spread your wings, draw more from your culture, draw from other art, other sculptures, other things around you. So, like everybody else, when I came here 24 years ago, for me Goa was like anybody else's view, full of churches and beaches. That's what I thought Goa was for me, a party destination. But we as creative people today have to add to that. I spent the last 24 years trying to change this image, party destination and beach and church destination, to be taken seriously, a Goa that should be taken seriously. And one way of doing it is through art, poetry, writing, and so on. This is from the net, and this is what most people do. Come to Goa, church in the background, coconut trees, a little pathway, and this Dilwale Dulhania Le Jayenge post. So let's tell people there is another side to Goa, there's more to Goa than just this. If somebody digs a little deeper after the Dilwale Dulhania portrait of Goa, they will look at this. Oh, there are soldiers on the gateposts. There are females of lions. How curious. How incredibly charming. If you dig a little deeper, you'll see the festivals. So this is one festival where people actually travel to San Juan. And I don't want to cast a dark sort of cloud over the festival. But I don't know how many of you know that the night before this festival, there are people who go around dressed in black with palm fronds painted in black and hitting the stones of the pathway around the churches and chapels. Did you know this? No. And what do they cry out when they do this? Any idea? They say, Judea, Judea. What does that mean? Yes, the Jews. So this started with the... This is a certain aspect of the festival which we should understand. And once we understand the festival that we are enjoying, we must also include this in our thoughts and prayers. That are there, first of all, there are no Jews in Goa, I'm told. But why attack one community even today, in this day and age? So it's time now for us to examine our own roots and our own culture. This is also another view of Goa when you dig deeper. You walk through Fontaineers, you look at the architecture, look at the paddy fields, you understand the life of in a Goan village. You start looking at the houses, so you're going deeper and deeper into your own culture. And architecture, art, sculpture, all this is very much part of your culture. Mother of pearl shell windows, where did they come from? Examine, ask yourselves. This is a very familiar picture. This was a private house, in fact, this one, and turned into Panjim Inn very, very deftly. This was a school that was turned into Hitanjali Gallery. I think most of you are familiar with it. And there's Panjim Pozada also. This makes a little Panjim Inn square. And this is how we have seen in our last 20 years how heritage can be converted from dilapidated old things into something that's alive, something that we can relate to. This is the interior. So beautifully, all the furniture was bought, repaired, restored, and exhibited. There's also the temple Goa, and one of the very interesting aspects of this, you've seen it, Arti, is any notice anything about these feet? Yeah, footwear, yes. These are called barukas. And six toes, yeah. I don't know what it means yet. I've been asking people, I show this to just about everyone. Is it like a touch of divinity or what? This is from Kanpur. Now we come to the pith of our talk today. Has anybody seen this art? You've seen it. No, I call it, this art is called Kaavi or Scrafito by the Portuguese scholars. And I also call it architectural art because it's always found on buildings and in temples, churches and sacred spaces. So one of the things I feel it does is it defines a sacred space. So when you see it in a house, for example, that door which leads to an altar or a temple or leads to a kitchen even, which is considered sacred, this art you will find. Why do I call it maritime or marine art? I call it because of the snake and the fish, mother of pearl shells, the lotus. So it's also an aquatic art. So Kaavi can be, I mean, I'm supposed to be standing here in front of you and talking like an expert, but there is no expert on Kaavi. There is no such thing as expertise on Kaavi. Because everywhere you go, you learn something new. If you go to Karnataka, and I'll show you pictures of one of our friends who's working in Karnataka on Kaavi, he'll tell you a completely different thing about Kaavi. If you ask Savani Shetty, who's a scholar on Kaavi, she'll tell you something new, something different. So Kaavi can be interpreted in many ways. But it's definitely Goan, and it's definitely folksy, and it's definitely a sacred art. Sorry, am I in the way? Okay. This is a temple also in Kanpur, done in cement. So Kaavi can be interpreted in many different ways, in many different mediums. And I would say you can expand it to various mediums. One of my friends in Mumbai took some motifs from me and has got a whole dinner set made with the motif. These are different pictures. These are the different what we call mudras. Now, Kaavi, what I have done personally is divided into three groups. One is borders, which you see on windows, doors, and entrances to temples. The other grouping is of figurative art, figures like this and this. And the third is the medallion and the borders. It is not necessary that you should follow the same, but here it is, this is what I've done. Here's a detailed look of the various borders. It's mostly floral, lotus buds, and this what I call the wave pattern. Now another thing is I wanted to tell you is that everybody calls it whatever they like. So Savani, for example, calls it rope, and I call it wave. There's no standard nomenclature in Kaavi. You can interpret it the way you want. There's very little figurative work in Christian Kaavi or Scrafito, most of the figurative work that we see, human figures and animals and cobras, for example, they are all seen in Hindu homes. This is from a temple in Bicholim. A man with a very strange haircut. And this is the Boruskar. Sorry. This is from a guest house, the Boruskar house, which is a Desai house in Borus village in Kankon. And very, very sad to report that the house has collapsed now, almost collapsed. And this was a guest house in the old days. The reason for the collapse is that the various parts of the house were owned by different people. And if the owner of this part of the house left Goa and went off to Bombay or somewhere else, it got neglected. But what is interesting is that they used to use this guest house to entertain guests who came to buy the agricultural products from them. So it was and this was considered very important and therefore decorated with kami. The house that collapsed also had a very rare thing called, frescoes in the guest house. Now here you see, this I have not seen anywhere else, a narrative in the frescoes. Here is a scene on the right, where a family of trapeze artists are performing to show that it's a dangerous occupation. There's a cobra inside the medallion and the landlord is shown reclining and enjoying the performance. The other thing here, the other fresco in panel over here is of a bhatkar wearing a tamri topi. Does anyone know why tamri topi? A red cap? Okay, when the Hindus left because of the pressure to convert to Catholicism, the economy started collapsing in Goa. So they were invited to come back. When they came back, they were given a red cap as a mark of honor. They were supposed to wear this red cap and walk around. This bhatkar apparently is wearing a red cap with pride. European style upper garment, coat, sitting on a European style chair, barefoot Indian style, barefoot lower garment of the dhoti. Now you can't see it very well, but he's holding this little pinky up. Can anyone guess why? Because this pinky has a very long nail, and that is to show that I don't do any manual labor. Now look, compare this, the composition, not the material, not the art, but compare the composition with what you see on the right. This is Lakshmi Narayan temple in Ankola, in Karnataka. But you see, I see a similarity, I don't know if you do. There's a similarity in the composition. The border, a frame, medallions on the side, a border on top and a border at the bottom. So this structure, this composition has also been exported along with the art. This is repainted, unfortunately, but the original was definitely done in Kaavi. Now what exactly is Kaavi? And why are we so excited about it? Is it just painting on the walls? Anybody guess? Red color, what's very emotionally connect? Why do we connect emotionally to red? To Tamri Mati? Tamra Rasto? We go and connect with the red earth. And this is a soil art. So, soil is taken, sifted twice, fine paste, mixed with something called pal puri, which is the juice of the sap of the liana plant. Charcoal added for binding and made into a very thin paste. In fact, the Kaavi, this is Janardhan in Udipi, Karnataka, is doing his PhD in Kaavi at the Karnataka University. And he is actually showing us how it is done. So, I'll show you a few pictures of the actual work that he's doing. He's taken plywood, of course, which the original artist will do on the wall. If you have lots of red, you put the red first. If you have lots of white, you put the white first. These are the tools which he himself has designed and made. So he takes this red plywood and he draws out the drawing with the bodkin. He scrapes out the red, fills it with white again. This is probably how the original artist also worked. You can do it in the reverse order as well. Initially, some 15 years ago, I used to say, no, it's white first and then red. But there's no hard and fast rule. So even I'm learning as I go along. So that's Janardhan completing his Saraswati figure. And this is the Ganesh he made also. And we'll hopefully have an exhibition of his work. He's going to bring all his work to go out very soon. This is a little gemstone. Most of the Kaavi that we see everywhere is painted over. Vijay Durga temple or Morjai temple, everywhere, almost everywhere, it's painted over. But here we see in Maharashtra, just across the border, very close to Savatwadi, in a village called Zolme, intact. The Kaavi original is intact. Not tampered with at all. These are the different columns, and every column in that temple, Sabha Mandapa, is different. You won't see the same design repeated twice. And this is what actually starts. There's always a narrative. Normally in Kaavi, it's mostly border, it's decorative. But here in this Zolme temple of Mauli, Sri Mauli, we see a narrative. This is probably Yashoda instructing her son not to steal yogurt, something like that. I don't know, that nobody can. But this is what I imagine. And this is the story of Garuda rescuing the serpent. Anybody know the story? Tell, pardon?
Basically, there was a serpent king.
Drowning.
Yeah. Okay, I think he would be the best one.
A serpent king is drowning, and Garuda, who's the eagle, sees him. And he sees him and he rescues him. And he saves his life and takes him to the nest and with his own feathers cleans him up and dries him up. Now, that goes against what we always believe that the that Garuda or the eagle is the enemy of the snake. So when I spoke to Dr. Rajendra Kerkar and I said, how come? He's got this benign expression and he said, no, in Goa we believe that even if our enemy is in, even if it's an enemy and he's in trouble, we must save him. I'm getting goosebumps. So that started this book actually, Grinding Story, because I asked him, Rajendra Kerkar, if he had, if this story had been written anywhere, and he said yes, they sing it as an ovio on the grinding stone. And that's how I started collecting grinding stories. Otherwise, I'm not an ethnography person, I'm not even supposed to be in that field. These are some images from Karnataka, quite delicate, quite elaborate, all narrative in nature. This is Mr. Padmanabh Prabhu's house. In fact, we saw the Kaavi there. We were walking around and Tushar, my photographer, and I said, we started taking pictures. I said, no, let me ask for permission. And when we knocked on his door, he and his sons just stood staring at us because he had Googled me just that morning. He said, Sakshat Lakshmi is in front of me. So, and he allowed us to take pictures. The house, and in Angola. Now there's another thing that happened. People migrated to Karnataka. Some of them were artists. They must have taken the art with them to Karnataka. And then when times were peaceful again and not so much turbulent, they must have come back. When they came back, they brought influences from Karnataka. Now this is from that same temple in Cholin. You see a similarity. This is Yakshagana art form, a performing art form from Karnataka. And here we have a similar, and including the what I think is the stage. So art is not something that can be rigidly put in boxes, as you all know. You have to imbibe from other cultures, introduce your own culture into it, and let there be a confluence, let there be a sangam of ocean, rivers, streams, etc. Now this art has also come to old Goa in a different format. Very little figurative work in the Christian Kaavi. There's only the double-headed eagle, which I'll show you in a second, and there's a mitra or the cap that Archbishop wears. A very little figurative Kaavi in Christian art. They used it purely as a decorative art form. This is a concert at the Chapel of Haleri of the Mon, held every first week of February, first, second, third. And you can see lots of Kaavi at the back. It's purely decorative. This is from Our Lady of Rosary Church in Old Goa. What I think is, you can see a part of the picture that's cut on the top, that's like the Archbishop's hat. Otherwise, it's purely decorative. Here's the double-headed eagle, also seen in Indian iconography. You see a double-headed eagle in stone. So there is an exchange between the stone work and the Kaavi work. What I see as the lotus in the center and radiating out in a very elaborate stylized petal form. Also a lotus from old Goa. And this, as I said, the book is freely available. I'm happy to share it with you, because the more awareness we spread on the Kaavi art, the better. And I also wanted to thank all these people who are my Kaavi heroes, my soldiers, gladiators. This is Rajendra Kesar. That's Daniel D'Souza, who accompanies me on every trip. These are my two angels right here, Kaushalya. Come on, take a bow. And Ramdas Gadekar, who've done a directory of Kaavi. I have a photocopy of the directory. It's with my friend Anna Maria. Anybody wants to take a look at the directory can later. This is what the directory is looking like now. I've got 150 of these motifs, because it's architectural art and it's highly endangered and it can collapse at any time, because if the building goes, the art goes. Just as we have seen in the Boruskar house. So what we did, what I decided to do was collect all the images, and Ramdas and Kaushalya have put them in line drawings, pen and ink, so that we have a directory. Somebody wants to relook Kaavi and it's happening, then you can use the motifs that we have. There's another angel, this is Samini Shetty and Sonia. And Sonia has used the motifs to make these pictures for me. She's put these four festivals and used Kaavi as borders. Natasha Fernandez from Museum of Christian Art has done a lot for Kaavi. And that's my friend Nina Sopnani, Dr. Nina Sopnani, who designed the book, Grinding Story. She and her chatty buddies. Here's another Kaavi here. She's doing her MA, Kranti Chari, doing her MA in Kaavi. That's also from that Zolme temple. And Natasha has put out products with Kaavi, of course, from her own museum. So we've got little sling bags, pouches, and so on. Little keychains. And that lion over there is one of the other figurative artworks that you don't see normally. She's got it hidden. In a sort of niche. So she made keychains because that area is not accessible. She's also, Sonia has used Kaavi as for her seven goddesses paintings at the last Serendipity Arts Festival. She used Kaavi for Moja because Moja has a lot of Kaavi. Of course, a lot of it is painted, but some parts, if you go there and look carefully, they have preserved the original. I end this talk with a dedication to my friend Jivi Sethi, who was an iconic figure in Goa, passed away this year of cancer. And Jivi was a collector of art, a patron of art, and also a fashion icon. So Jivi, I hope you're watching us right now. Thank you all very much. And for your friends and anybody who wants to come for the talk and who couldn't make it today, I'm going to speak again on the 19th at Gallery Geetanjali at 6 p.m. So do please come. It's a Goa Heritage Action Group event. Thank you.